Bias versus variance, why being too smart is dumb. This is my contribution to the Summer of Math Exposition 1. So maybe the title is a little bit clickbaity, I'm sorry, but the concept is really important if you ever want to do something useful in machine learning. So let's get to it. Right, so I said it was important in machine learning, so let's just discuss machine learning for 1 second before moving on with the bias versus variance trade-off. So when doing supervised learning, the idea is to learn to take some input and predict the correct output. And one example of this is to take a handwritten image of a number and then get the machine to recognize what number it is. So learning to read numbers, I guess. You must prepare sufficient data examples where one data point is an example of an input and the desired outputs, so you're giving the computer the answers. Let's represent a dataset with this gray cube, and you must prepare enough of those examples in the dataset. You then feed the machine learning these data points, but just keep on tweaking the parameters in the machine learning model until it can correctly take an image and classify it correctly. Kind of like a teacher to student scenario where the teacher is providing some examples and the correct answer. So after we have done tweaking the machine, we take the data points and measure how good it is. Like, how often do you correctly classify an image? And it turns out if you have given enough data examples and the model is sufficiently complex, like it's clever enough, then the error will go to absolutely zero. It will never classify an image wrongly. And this seems all well and good, right? Like, the error is zero, are we done? Well, no, it's not good, actually. So we have used the same training examples for training and testing. And that's kind of like student going to an exam where the student had already seen the question and the answers. So the machine learning model could have just learned to remember the answers and not learned anything at all. Therefore, we must go back and then we take this data set and then we split it up. We only use this set, the training set, for training the algorithm. And then we use the other set, should be called an exam set, I guess. And this data set, we will check how well it performs once we are done tweaking the model. So this is the golden measurement, the error of the unseen data. The green line is the theoretical value of the test set. It is higher than the error of the training set. There exists some optimal balance between model complexity. It turns out model complexity is related to bias and variance. But first, the error can be decomposed into three things: the bias, the variance, and the noise. But we can't get rid of the noise, so let's ignore that. Why can you decompose the error into bias and variance? Let me give you an example. Now we want to make an algorithm that puts out the number 10. Yeah, right, so that's really, really easy. So that's the goal, that's the target function predicts the number 10. Right, so that's the target, that's called y. And now comes in one try of estimating y, and that's called, of course, called y hat, so that's our estimate of the target function. And it turns out that it is always kind of off the target, and that's called the bias. It's the true value minus the expectation value, and it measures how often we are consistently wrong. Right, so that was one bad estimation of hitting the number 10. Now comes in another approximator, and this approximator is everywhere around the target. And this is, of course, the variance. This is the equation for the variance. It doesn't take into account the actual answer. It just measures how spread out the data points are to each other. Right, so that was the two examples where one example was really biased and one example was highly variant. And so an actual attempt would consist of both errors. So there will be some spread in the prediction, and there will be some bias. And when you make a machine learning model, you must try to balance how much bias you have and how much variance you have. And somewhere in between, there is an optimal balance. Blue is the bias and purple is the variance. Adjusting each other leads to an optimal balance, an optimal lowest error. But up until now, I haven't shown you what model complexity is and how it relates to bias and variance. Let's do that with yet another example. Okay, here is an example that we could be trying to learn with machine learning. Say that this is an absolutely true function for hours in the sun and the corresponding cell damage. Say we don't know this relation, this black line here, this is the actual true function biology give us, but we don't know it. And this graph is a second degree polynomial with these values. We team up with a doctor that measures some patients for us and get these data points. The data points can't be exactly on the true line because of noise and randomness, but we got some data points out of it. But this is our data set. As I said earlier, we'll split the data set into a training set and a test set. So now I'll try to fit this with two different polynomials. First, a 0-degree polynomial, so just a number, and then a 5-degree polynomial. And now it's time to measure how good we performed, so we'll measure the error of the test set. So that's the average distance to the test points. It turns out the 0th-degree polynomial is highly, highly biased, and this means that this machine learning model has underfit. It was not able to capture the patterns. And the 5th-degree polynomial was highly, highly variant. It fitted too well on the noise. The data is, of course, highly spread out. Like, the variance is really, really high. The model is overfit. It captured the noise in the dataset. We must control the bias and the variance. So now we will try to vary the degree of the polynomial in order to vary the bias and the variance. So you can also say that you model the complexity of the model. The higher degree polynomials we have, the more learnable parameters we have. So this essentially what we're doing, we are adjusting the complexity of the model in order to adjust the bias and variance. By adjusting the complexity, the polynomial degree, so above, I'm showing you the bias and the variance and the total error given by this equation. Turns out we have found an optimal value for the bias and variance right here. That's the lowest error of the test set. It wasn't able to find the correct second degree polynomial, but we also had a very, very small data set. Overfit means you have a low error on the training set, but a high error on the test set. Underfit means you have a high error on the training set and a high error on the test set as well. It sounds so weird, we'll need to control or maybe even introduce some bias or some variance in order to get a low generalization error. If the model is not sophisticated enough, it doesn't have enough complexity, enough learnable parameters. 7. If the model is too clever, too complex, it has too many learnable parameters, it's going to see all the noise in the dataset and it will find the wrong patterns. Wait a minute, this paper is slightly bent over here. This is a clearly indication that the answer cannot be 4. This must be 5, perhaps. Somewhere in between there is some good balance between being too dumb and too smart. It's 10. Making a model dumber is called regularization. And I showed you that by reducing the polynomial degrees. When using regularization in a neural network, it's called dropouts or optimizing via brain damage. So you just simply remove connections between neurons to make it dumber. You can also regularize a decision tree by pruning. There you have it, a mathematical relationship showing you why it is a good idea to find a balance between underthinking and overthinking. And now you can make a better machine learning model. This video was brought to you by very generous patrons. Thank you very much for the help. Help me produce more science content and become my patron, or check out my science gifts. They are available as NFTs.